Welcome back. We're continuing on with Chapter 6, Points, Lines, and Polygons. And we're now going to tackle point set and index line set, the points and lines in points, lines, and polygons. So let's go there. Point set node. Very simple node. It just creates a bunch of points in space. And there is a pattern here that we'll see over and over again with many of the geometry nodes, and that's the use of a contained coordinate node, which has the point data of interest. And in this case, the rendering is pretty simple, that we are just plotting each coordinate as an independent point. As a result, we don't need a coordinate index or any other connecting information between the points because they're not connected. They're simply there. However, there is an issue with this. Simplicity is good sometimes and bad some other times. Drawing the points is just fine, but when we do so, we see that they're defined to be a single pixel. And as a result, this can make perspective and distance pretty hard to render. If we think about it, we go, well, yeah, what is a point anyway? In geometric mathematical terms, it's a location in space, but it's infinitesimally small. So how big is small? Big enough to see, but not too big, get far away or not. The perspective turns out to be pretty difficult. We take the stance in X3D, at least so far, the way this works is we draw it as one pixel in size, and let's take a look at what that means. In the notes, we have a definition here on pixelation, and you might have heard the term pixel before. People throw it around. It's actually an acronym. And it stands for picture element. The size of the smallest element that can be drawn on a computer screen. Okay, and so how big is a pixel? Answer, it depends. What screen are you drawing it on? And for example, the laptop I'm showing this on, it shifted its pixel size, the number of pixels horizontal and vertical, to get on a projector. The computer you may be using to look at the slides could have a different setting. And if you print out the slides, print out any of these pictures, it could have yet another setting, 300 dots per inch, perhaps even 600 dots per inch. But, oh, wait a minute, how big is a dot? A dot is not the same as a pixel. So we have all these variations. So that's why it's a little bit problematic, a little bit tricky. Now, that said, we do have some restrictions on it. We can't light them. We can't texture map them. We don't collision detect them. So it is a little bit of, I don't know, fairy dust. It is usable, but we typically don't. It's nevertheless something to keep track of, I think, because in graphics research, points have sort of been overlooked for many years, but there's actually a field now of research that's getting a bit of resurgence, and that would be point-based rendering. And there's actually one or two good books on these now, some of which collect together a bunch of papers on how effective this can be done. So I would suspect that this is an area for improvement in X3D. You can use it now, but use it sparingly, perhaps as a special effect, perhaps just experimental. In the future, we might get very serious about this, and it wouldn't take a lot to add that kind of support. Okay. When you color your pixels, you can do it in two ways. You can either give them a single color, and it would be used in the material node. And importantly, only the emissive color would be the color that matters when you color a point. So that tells you that points will always be glowing. That reinforces the previous point. They're not lit. They don't keep track of what lights are shining on them or what angle. If you don't want a single color, but you want different colors, then you would use the contained color node or a color RGBA node. And as, just as your coordinate would have a set of points one by one, your color RGBA color node could have a corresponding set of colors. So let's take a look at that. Here's our point set line. Our point set node. So if we look at the point set, we see that it is pretty simple. In fact, there are no fields at all there. All it has is contained content. So if we look at the coordinate node in here, we can see that it's a series of points, coordinates one at a time. About 20 points here. Okay, and if we want to look at this scene, well, that's the wrong way to do it. We'll try again. Undock it. Look at the viewpoints. You can see that we have a shark swimming around the track that's following the points. So if we look very closely at this screen, you can see the points. They're a little easier to see if you move the screen while you're going. Yeah, go ahead, get the light scan. Let's see if that shows it a little better. I think you can just make them out barely there. And we've put some motion into this scene to help emphasize where the points are. It helps also if you have a clean screen. if it's dirty, you might not be able to see it so well. Okay, now the actual swimming takes up a large part of this scene, and we can see that there's a group that we'll study in the next chapter, a group of nodes, time sensor and position interpolator and orientation interpolator. And basically what they're doing is they're sending values to a transform node and changing the transform node of the shark as it goes around. The shark itself brought its own swimming behavior with it, so we didn't have to mess around with this. Okay, and we won't get into those things. The main part to follow here is the point set node and the coordinate. Okay, if we wanted to create our node or our own, we could. What we would do is we would drag in a color node to be next to the coordinate node, and we could just add colors one at a time here. And you can see it's fairly easy to add the colors. I'm looking forward to getting the index counts added so that we can move these colors up and down and check that they match the right index for the right points. Perhaps someday we'll even get a side-by-side edit capability. That might be interesting. Okay. That's how you do it. Okay, so let's go to the next one. Here's the screen snapshot. And again, point set is utterly simple. I can see there's a slight mistake in the snapshot here. Sometimes it gets condensed into one, so let's fix that while we're here. Point set, edit, and we can see that there's container field and defuse as part of this. Okay, and there we go. All fixed. And finally, tooltips. Not much to say. We just do one point at a time. Okay, let's look at the next node now, index line set. And like point set, index line set has been around all the way since the original VRML virtual reality modeling language in 97, the VRML 97 spec. And once again, it contains a coordinate node, which in turn contains the three tuple point data. So what's nice about line set is we can draw, it's more than just a single line segment, it's multiple line segments, and those multiple line segments can be connected, or they can be disjoint, where we have separate ones. So the formal term for that is called a polyline. And that is the connected line segments within that. Okay. Once again, they're not lit, not texture mapped, which means they get their color elsewhere. And where do they get their color? Well, just as before, the material node emissive color. So it does glow. Glows in the dark, meaning we turn out the lights, we'll still see our lines, we'll still see our points. Okay. And if we don't want a same color for all of the line segments, we can use some coloring techniques with the color node once again. And we can do that either per line segment, have it all one color, or per individual point where the color will vary over the stretch of the line. Okay, so let's take a look at that. Here's what our case looks like. And we can see here in the use of this node that it's very important that we have within our line segment, we have a negative one showing where the line segment starts and stops. Now on this one, that's maybe not so important because it's only a single polyline. It's only a single set of connected line segments. But if we had more than one in there, then we'd have more than one negative one value to indicate a split in the line. So that negative one value is often called a sentinel. A sentinel value means it's not an actual value because there's no underlying coordinate that has an index value of negative one. So as an index, it's not would not be legal, but it's a specially defined term, a sentinel, to flag for us that, oh, okay, this breaks one and this starts the next. If we put in a negative two or a negative five, that would not work. Those would be illegal and should throw an error. Okay, so let's take a look at the example. If I can get it to wake up. Okay, here we go. Index line set, I'll bring out the example, and as before, we'll check out our viewpoints, and we have two that came along with Lucy, one behind and one ahead. So all the animation in this scene, indeed the points in this scene, are about the same, and we can use it to take a look at the line segment that's drawn. And you can see we're not only positioning the top of the shark so that it is going through the points, but we're orienting the shark as it travels so that its heading is along the direction of the next line segment. Okay, let's take a look at some other line segments here. In this case, index line segments. We'll finish up with this one. We'll check the display. And yes, it does match the one that's shown here. This is a pretty simple one, 0 through 17. And notice that 0 here says we're repeating the first and the last coordinate. And that's why we ended up with a loop. If we had left off the last 0, then the line segment, the polyline, would not be closed, but rather open with a gap in it instead of fully closed. Let's check another example. And let's see if my tool is still set up properly. A few local examples. We'll go to the source book. And we'll go to the lines chapter. Here it is, chapter 13, points, lines, and faces. And in this case, we have an indexed set for a box. Okay, if we look at that definition in the HTML here, in the pretty print, we can look at our index line set and say, well, this is pretty simple. It has several line segments. There's the first one, there's the second, there's the third, fourth, and fifth. Let's see if I got that right. No, I didn't. Okay, that's a little closer. Okay, so it looks like we have 6 line segments, and this goes first 4 points and a 4 connected points right here. All right, 0, 1, 2, 3, 0. Then we have 4 connected points right here, 4, 5, 6, 7, back to 4. And then we have a couple of 4 single segments up and down. So let's go ahead and open up this example. You've probably figured out at this point, how did we build the box? Well, the coordinates, if we think about it in a box here, we have 8 vertices, 8 points. And then we've drawn a box on the bottom, we've drawn a box on the top, and then we've connected the top and bottom through the intermediate points. Okay, so let's find this example and pull it up. Chapter 13, index line set, box wireframe. Here's our indexed line set. Sure enough, it's just connecting a bunch of coordinates with the coordinate index field. And then if we look at the coordinates themselves, we can see that, it's all ones and negative ones. Oh, okay, that's because it's a unit box. If we look at the Y as the vertical axis, then first we have the box that goes around above the origin, and then in the second half we have the box that goes around below the origin. So above and below. We then see the pattern for the XY coordinates where we've just drawn a square. And then similarly, we've repeated that below. Okay, so if we take a look now and trace the indices of this guy, let's get the indices back on the screen, and then re-pull up our points. It's making it tricky for me. Let's try again. See if I can out-trick it. What I may have to do is split this guy so my editor doesn't jump. Here we go. Okay, so what we're looking at is the connectivity of these points then. 0, 1, 2, 3, 0. Okay, so that's indices 0, 1, 2, 3 for a total of 4 points. And again, they're reconnected beginning to end. So there's our first box. Now let's look at the second one. We have that -1 sentinel value to split them out. And then 4, 5, 6, 7, 4. Okay, so it starts with 0, 1, 2, 3, sure enough. 4, 5, 6, 7. And then connecting back to 4. There's our second box. And then finally we have the verticals. Okay, so this vertical is 0 and 4. Second vertical, 1 and 5. Third vertical, 2 and 6. And finally the fourth vertical. If I can get my pen to behave, is 3 to 7, the last in the first box, the last in the second. Okay, so little low level, little tedious, but it's essentially a counting problem. Can you keep track of where you're going? And so I absolutely recommend when you're doing this kind of stuff is have a piece of graph paper handy and draw the things you want and label the vertex on each one on your graph paper, and then you can more easily keep track of these things and more easily check your scene. Okay, there's a little bit more to say about index line set actually. And let's launch this in an external browser and take a look at it. Okay, now if we go to examine mode and we rotate this, when we first start out it looks pretty much fine, but as you turn it you can usually tell what's the front and what's the back, but every so often it changes. In fact, if you think you know what the front and the back is, why don't you close your eyes? Okay, now you can reopen them again and tell me conclusively which is the front corner and which is the back corner. There's two that could be it. I mean, it could be this guy or it could be that guy. So if you think about it for a second, that's probably the only one that makes sense because we know that it's a regular cube. But this one could also make sense if it was a less than regular cube. Now, let's exaggerate this problem and just turn it more. And if you turn it enough, either by yourself or watching somebody else and look away and look back in, it is possible usually to tell where you're going, but sometimes when it's just sitting there and you just come back and look at it, it's hard to tell immediately what's front and what's back. like for example, this shape right here, is this a cube or is this actually a truncated pyramid where this is the top of a truncated four-sided pyramid and this is the bottom? Okay, tricky business. So the reason for this, why is it tricky, is let's look closely at these lines. Gee, they're all 1 pixel wide. I can keep getting closer and closer to them, and we can see that they're basically the same size. Okay, so the rules of perspective are broken. This is also sometimes called an orthographic view. Which is actually used sometimes in computer-aided design and architecture and things like that, where you intentionally break the rules of perspective in order to see something properly. Well, like it or not, that's what you get with Lineset, at least in our current implementations. So this has to be a known limitation when you're authoring. So you probably want to be sparing in the use of your lines, because if you have tons and tons and tons of lines in there, it's hard to tell which ones are up front and which ones make sense, which one to pay attention to. Let's play with this a little more. Since this index line set only has 8 points, it should be a little easier for us to add colors. So let's do so. And let's go red. Orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo and violet are a little harder, so I'll do cyan, darker violet, and then white and black. And that's, of course, the infamous character of legend, Roy G. Biv, who's the name that's the acronym for what are the colors in the rainbow? Red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet. Okay, so there are our colors. And something it didn't like. Okay, that's interesting. Let's see if we can do it. It didn't like my putting a color in the shape node. So let's accept it and take another closer look at the validation. So there's our problem. Okay, when I dragged and dropped it, I put it outside the index line set, but it should go right next to the index line set because it belongs inside the, it belongs next to the coordinate, so it belongs inside the index line set. So since I went to all that work to create those colors, that's why I accepted it to troubleshoot a little further. We'll now cut it, paste it. We'll even reformat this guy to clean it up. We'll even format it further with canonicalization. And now we have our coordinates, our colors. Let's revalidate. Sure enough, this time it worked. Okay, and then I'm gonna save it and reload it, and let's see what we have. Okay, look at that. So this time we have colors assigned to each of the points, and we see there's a nice blending on there because it's color per vertex. Each color got assigned to each point. Let's vary that a little further. If we look at our index line set, notice there's a field in here color per vertex, which we have checked by default true. Well, what if we unchecked that guy? What would we get? Let's try it out. Save. Reload. Well, look at that. Instead of using 8 colors, it looks like it used 6 colors. Looks like my orange is kind of close to the yellow. We'll tweak that. Make the orange a little darker. Save. Reload. Okay, so that's more clearly distinguished now. And another way to do things. Which one's right? Whichever one you want. Okay, so what do you think? Is that a good example to add into our own thing? Yeah, I think so. So we'll add that. So let's go back to File, Save As, and we'll put that back in the directory for the book. Okay, Save As. There it is in the new directory. I'll clean that up a little bit later. Of course, give credit where credit's due to the original example. And then let's go back to this one. I was changing it so we could fiddle with it and test, but I don't want to mess up the original version. So since this has version control, we can just revert all those modifications, and I could kill them like that. If I wanted to see what the changes were, I could also go to Subversion and do a diff and go, oh yeah, 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 there are my changes right there. They're localized to those couple of lines. We changed 2 lines to 3. So I could either revert as we showed before or, let's see, do we have a revert here? I guess we can use this thing. Maybe not. Okay, so we'll just kill the diff. I'll revert it so we don't corrupt the master copy here. And I think end of story. Let's see if we got everything on line set. Yeah, that should do it. Index line set. So let's look at our next node now. Our next node is almost identical to line set, and it's called index line set. So what's the difference? Well, no indexing, right? Let's see what that means. Let's see what that implies. Okay, we have a slightly different construct in this one. Instead of keeping track of the color index and the coordinate index to match, mix and match, they have a vertex count field. Okay, and the way vertex count works is it's not a single value, but it's MF, multi-field array. So it's an array of values. So each value in there would determine how many segments are used at a time. This means we don't need any -1 values in there. And we just march through the contained color and coordinate values and pull out, okay, first 3 here, then 5 there, then 7 there. Or if we did it for our example that we just did, we would see that in this case, the first example we did, the count was simply 19. That's how many points were in the example. But if we went back to our previous example, we said, what would the vertex count be for our cube? Well, for the cube, we had a series of six line segments, correct? We had the base, which would give us a value of 4. And then we had the top, which would give us a value of 4. And then we would have the 2-point vertices for each vertical that we drew. So it would be 2, 2, 2, 2. And so for our cube example, if you're going to reconstruct that using a line set node, this would be how we do it. And so we can see it is slightly more compact than the version we had before. How so? Let's bring it back up, the version we had before, and that's over here. And we can see there was our connectivity information before. So if we compare that array to 4, 4, 2, 2, 2, 2, we can see that vertex count is a little smaller than coordinate index. That's the upside. However, the downside is some of these points are used more than once. Okay, this point here, for example, on the cube is used by 3 different segments. So the downside, it would be if we're just using coordinates right out of the coordinate node, points right out of the coordinate node, and there's repetition of that point, then if we used line set, then we would have to repeat them in the array. Okay, so we have reduced vertex count but the downside would be an increased coordinate points, and that would be due to repetition. Okay, so this is a theme we'll see again and again when we compare nodes that have an indexed version versus a non-indexed version. The indexed version gives you more flexibility about connectivity inside there, and it lets you reuse colors, reuse coordinates. So for very large models, that becomes significant. You can have a significant size savings. For line set, on the other hand, since we're just using a chunk at a time and just pulling them off out of the point array, out of the color array, that works great if there's very little repetition. But it can be redundant, somewhat wasteful of space, if there is repetition in there. In other words, if it is a highly connected mesh. Okay, so 2 different representations, pros and cons for each. Visually, they look identical. You can construct the same lines, and in fact, when I modify that cube example, we'll probably put 2 cubes side by side, one with index line set and one with line set, so we can get a direct comparison of the trade-offs and values. We'll see these same kinds of themes repeated in Chapter 13, which goes over the triangle nodes and the quadrilateral nodes. Once again, just like with lines, there are low-level forms for each of the triangle nodes that are take great advantage of the coordinate and the color nodes. And they either use indexing to reach in there, or they use pull them off a chunk at a time. Okay, so that said, we don't have to wait to Chapter 13 to get into the details of, now that we know how to do points and lines, how do we do polygons? That's our next node, index face set, and that's where we're going to pick up next time. So we'll see that index face set followed by elevation grid and extrusion
are actually three very powerful nodes, and we can construct just about any geometry we want to with those three. In fact, index face set's powerful enough we can create anything at all. But elevation grid and extrusion have their own virtues and make it easy to create certain shapes. Okay, so we'll see you there.